Welcome to It's Not Just You, Girl, where we are real, uncut, raw, and yet holy about the things we face in life as women and how we can overcome them. I'm your host, Aya, and let's get into this, joyful people. Hi, beautiful people. Here we go with another episode. Yeah. I'm so ready for this one, but I'm going to open this one with prayer. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, I ask that this message you have on my heart blesses the one whom which it's meant to bless. You know what your people need. You know what they're going through. And I'm just using myself as a vessel, Father. Let my flesh decrease all the way and your spirit increase fully and take over. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, y'all. I've been very emotional lately. I'm just going to say this. I don't know if I'm going to get emotional on this, but y'all know it's real and raw and I don't edit. So, I mean, maybe little things, but very rarely. I just know. I want to keep it as real as possible. And I really want to make it seem like we're just sitting down, because the point of this podcast is for me to let you guys know it's not just you, you know, and that's why I called it It's Not Just You, Girl, because I feel like a lot of times in this life, we are so guarded. We're so shielded. We don't let people in, and it's because we are afraid. So many people judge, you know, just like that, the parable that Jesus said, and he was like, you know, why would you start pointing at the speck or the sawdust in your brother's eye, but you don't look at the log, you know, the log, the plank in your own eye? And I think that is probably the most beautiful analogy. And the problem is that it's like the plank blinds us to the point, and we get so used to that plank being in our eye that we don't see it as a problem. But we can see that little speck on somebody else as an issue, as a, you know, as something dirty, as something that needs to be cleaned up. But, you know, where we get so used to our mess, we get so used to our dysfunction, and it's simply because nobody is open about it. So you find your best way to cope as you are. You know, one of my old colleagues, he said something. I had like a really crazy situation happen, like this whole, y'all, I've had some not the best luck in love, okay? And I was maybe 21, and it was really, really bad. And I ended up getting robbed and left, and I don't even know if my family knows this story. And it was just really bad. And when I went back to work that week and I told him the story, he was like, well, you did what you knew best to do at that moment with what you had. And that really helped me, because literally that's it. You cope as best as you can with the skills you have. May not be the right skills, may not be the best skills, but you use what you got to get through your current situation. And that is a beautiful thing, but also a hindering thing, because sometimes when you feel like something's a little off, or the only cop out you have is, that's just who I am, that's just how I act, that's just how I behave, but you really don't like it, that's when you don't allow yourself to reach your full potential and your full growth. So that was a little excerpt, but maybe somebody needed to hear it. But the main reason for this episode was to let people know we are not our problems. We are not the things that we go through. We are not the unfortunate situations that we either happen to just be, you know, happen to be a part of, happen to have happened to us, or happen to walk into through to, you know, due to whatever might have led us there. We are not those things. And I really want to say that because I felt like until I got closer to God from another unfortunate situation happening to me, that was when I understood that I had been carrying weight of my mistakes, of my problems, of my issues, and trying to be perfect or seem perfect because I felt like that's, you know, that's what it's supposed to be, you know, or knowing that it didn't feel right and knowing that I was different. And I just wanted to be real. I don't want to put up a facade. I don't know how to be fake. I don't know how to lie to you. I don't know how to be that person. You know, I don't even know how to truly hate somebody who has done their worst to me, because hate takes too much energy. And the good part about that is that that's what God wants. Like, God wants you to love your neighbor as yourself and bless those that curse you. You know, that's the beauty of it. But that's not what our world is about. It's, you know, we live in a world where they're like, you know, you treat me like this, I'ma uphold that same energy. You don't like me, I don't like you. We're not going to speak to each other. You step to me, I'ma step to you. And what does that do? What does that cause? What does that help? How does that make you feel afterwards? You know? Maybe it's a funny story later on. Maybe it's a this and that. But I don't think there's anything cute about somebody scratching the beautiful face Lord gave me and pulling out my edges. Let me tell you. And I'm a fighter. I have that in me. But that was not it. That was not it. Like, if you did, you know, back in my days, we first turned 21, I got in one drunk fight, and y'all, I don't think I went out the rest of the summer. Every time they asked me, you want to, I is not going. Okay, I need to think about my life. It's not, I didn't get beat up, nothing like that, but it was just the fact, the impact, the altercation and things like that. And there's people who do that every weekend, and it's just funny story after funny story after funny story. And that's the thing about the enemy, is that sometimes when you get so deeply rooted in things, you don't even know where the light is. You know, darkness just starts to seem so normal when it's not normal. You should feel some type of way. You know, it's not as funny as it thinks. The aftermath is not as cute as you like to make it seem. How far does it get you? Oh, again, I digress, y'all. I'm a rambler, so there's that too. But, you know, I feel like so many things happen to us and we carry the weight. We carry the weight of our parents' mistakes. We carry the weight of being rejected or neglected as a child. We carry the weight of, you know, the world, beauty standards, skin complexion, hair texture, to wear makeup, not to wear makeup, you know, Instagram baddie or, you know, modest, holy sister. I don't know, y'all. I don't know. You know, but all these things, you know, like, we got soft life. We got luxury glam. We have this. We have that. We have that. What happened to just being you? And if you call it something, that's your name for it. You know, kind of like poetry class. And that's just what you use to describe yourself. And it doesn't have to be a whole clique or gang gang type something, you know? Like, sometimes it's just like, what? These things, you know? And there's nothing wrong with it. But the problem is that it makes people want to be a certain way. It makes people want to do a certain thing. And in some aspects, it's good. If you see something you like, if you see something you relate with, maybe you don't feel very feminine and you want to work on your femininity. And you see somebody who's very feminine and they have a brand that's very feminine. So you kind of use it for inspiration. Go, kudos to you. You know, if you want to live a luxurious life, you love traveling, you want to go places, kudos to you. You know, if you got a 9-to-5 and you holding your stuff down, you got your apartment, kudos to you. You know, if you're a single mom, if you're married, if you're this or you're that, kudos to you on however you choose to live your life. And if you want to exceed, if you want to aim for better, aim for better. Perfect. But you don't have to fit in this mold, because you do. And this is the problem with the world that we live in that is just so social media based, that I feel like so many people literally are trying to fit into a niche, you know, and not all of us fit into niches, you know. I was talking to my sister friend, and she was like, Aya, why do you think that there's a box that can contain you? And literally started laughing. And I was just like, what? Because I was talking to her about, you know, doing this podcast and all of the things that I wanted to do, the keto recipes, you know, my wig boutique, bold statement boutique, all of the stuff that I'm doing. And I'm just like, how do I, and you know, dancing and Zumba and weight loss and life, and life is life and right now, and trying to be a mommy and trying to manage my home and like all these things. It becomes so much, and then you start to feel like each one of them has to have its own bubble. You know what I mean? So it's like, over here is luxury glam. Over here is this. Over here is that. Over here is that. But what's wrong with me encompassing parts from each of those of those categories? What's wrong with that? And why does that have to be a niche? Why does that have to be a bubble? Why can't Aya just be Aya? And people just be people? And like, awesome people. You know, why does there always have to be an aesthetic or a movement towards it? Which movements aren't bad, you know, depending on where they stand from, but sometimes the initial intent, because there's no intent, because there's no flexibility in it, you start to feel like you have to stay in a mold or stay in a bubble. But as human beings, we're forever evolving, you know. We go from glory to glory, and our circumstances continue to define us. The things we persevere through continue to define us. You know, the things that we overcome, the people we encounter, the things that we do, the things that we start reasoning, the things that we start to learn, the jobs, the positions, the places that we are taken to always evolve us. So you can't put somebody in a box like that. You know, and then what do? If somebody creates a niche and everybody falls into that bubble, basically you are following somebody in their own growth journey, when that's not the journey you're taking. That's not your path. And now all of a sudden you feel some type of way for breaking it. Okay, so I guess this kind of goes with what I was trying to say. But then, you know, the Holy Spirit does whatever he wants to do. So I hope this is blessing many of you. But yes, we carry so much weight on ourselves. We carry so much weight on ourselves. And because of that, sometimes we just get weighed down. I'm going to be transparent. I struggle with letting go and letting God, casting my burdens on Him and allowing Him to do what He's supposed to do. I struggle with patience and, you know, basically it's patience, you know, like my timing and God's timing is always very different. And I know a lot of us are like that, you know, a lot of us are like that. And I find because I am naturally a fixer, you know, I am the type of person that when something's not working, let's figure it out. You know, I don't have no money. I'm gonna cook them. I'm gonna start making plates and selling them for how much. And the funny thing is that I'm not even extroverted, y'all. I'm not an extrovert. I sit in my bubble a lot. I stay in the house a lot. I speak to myself a lot, you know, to speak to people, to say things. I get a little in my throat. You know, but of course, to live life and to do things and to not get passed by, you gotta assert yourself. So I learned how to, but you know, I naturally, that's just not what it is unless it comes to dancing and then I get on the dance floor, but I don't even join cliques or nothing. It's like, I just smile with you, we vibe, and then I'm going about my business, but that's about it. Like, you know, I'm very private, very personal, very introverted. And because of that, it is hard for me not to do something but pray and do what I know I'm supposed to do. And I know that sounds like that's all you can do. But for somebody like me, it's like, am I not supposed, do I need to talk to somebody? Something need to happen. Maybe I need to reach out. Maybe I need to do this. And then, you know, you find yourself just frustrated and annoyed. And then me trying to surrender and let God take control of whatever is burdening me. You know, he's the vindicator. He is the deliverer. He is also the one that supplies all of our needs. Regardless of what the circumstance is or the problem is that you are calling God's attention to, He will come through, especially if He told you He will. You know, He's not a man that He should lie. His promises stand. But, yeah. I struggle. And I mean, like, I struggled from two extremes. I had one time where I struggled so bad. I was just fasting all the time. And I dropped significant amount of weight very quickly. Not mad about that. Been on the weight loss journey. It was wonderful to look like that. And then I have gained that back and a little bit plus trying to surrender again because I carried the weight in another way. You know, the other way I was, and I feel like, you know, I have to ask myself, like, okay, what is it? What is it? Because I keep getting frustrated. I keep complaining about the same thing. I'm not being very grateful. I'm not in a place of thanksgiving. I'm not appreciating my surroundings. Though I do, I'm looking more at what's happening to me and how it looks like all of the things that people told me when I was younger is manifesting itself and looking very real. And that is exactly what I was avoiding, and my life is presenting itself that way. And then week after week, prayer after prayer, fast after fast, cry after cry, I'm not seeing a difference. Y'all, let me tell you, to praise is not easy. You know, it's not easy. Thank God for the Holy Spirit, who is your helper, because a song will just come into your spirit and you can't help but sing it and then want to play it. And then end up in a beautiful session. You know, when God is your best friend, he can't help but talk to him, even if it's like, Lord, I mean, I know you ain't forget about me. Can you show me a sign? Can you do something? You know, like Gideon, can you give me a fleece? can you do something? I need to know. Because right now, it's looking real dark. Okay? Real dark. And you are the way, the truth, and the light. Can you show me some light? A rainbow, some? I don't know. But I need to know. You know, I'm not going the wrong way. Because the thing is that my main reason for this is that we hold our problems, and instead of us saying, that sucks, and Lord, I know you saw that, and I know you're going to handle it in your timing. In the meantime, teach me how to be content and start looking at when God has come through for you, the things that God has promised you, and keep doing your part in whatever it is supposed to do. If that's looking internally, if that's, you know, understanding emotional intelligence, if that's, you know, putting together that book, if it's that, whatever it is that God has told you you need to do in direction to that path, even though it's not looking like it, you still keep walking towards it. You know, you still keep walking towards it. You know, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. But on the end of that, there's a table that has anointing that overflows, and where your enemies will see you being blessed when they thought they could take you down, when they kept reminding you of the things that you've done and the ways that you used to behave and the ways that you used to act, you know. And we hold these things to see if that's who we are. So when things are not working, I know for me, I start to say, it's because I've done all of these things in the past. Lord, let me know if I messed up, or I struggled that bad, or if I'm just that bad of a person, or I'm that wicked, or I'm this, or I'm that. And it's like, you just immediately start to, because, you know, for me, that was what always happened, or that's how it always seemed. I was always the problem. I was always the issue. Not that I didn't have part of the problem. Not that I didn't have part of the issue. But I always felt like I wasn't good enough. And I always felt like anything that I did or I touched will spoil. Because that's just who I am. I spoil things. You know, I don't make things brighter. I don't make things beautiful. I don't make successful things. I don't do all of these other things. Which are lies from the pit of hell. Lies. Period. Lies. And that's the thing. The enemy is the accuser of brethren. So what is he going to do? He's going to take one mistake that you made and amplify it. Instead of you to say, yes, I made this mistake and I messed up. But I'm going to learn from it. And I didn't like the way that I felt. I didn't like the way I reacted. I didn't like what I did. So, Lord, bring those things out of me, so I don't continue to behave that way. And just not carry the weight of this world. You know, so many things get dumped on us, but we don't have to accept it. You know, same thing. My sister friend, we were talking and she was like, you know, when it comes to you, you like let people put sticky notes on you. You know, you let people put sticky notes on you. And then when they put the sticky notes on you, you start asking like, what's this? Or how do I deal with it? And she was like, and you know, those sticky notes are untrue. You know, those sticky notes don't make you feel any better. They make you feel worse. They're full of lies. They're full of all these things. But yet you start asking questions to see if it's your problem, instead of you to just take it off and put it down. Throw it off of you. Brush it off of you. that's not a you problem. And I feel like a lot of times that's it. You know, you don't have a job right now, but you've been applying. So you start to feel like you're unhirable. People don't like you. Once again, you're rejected in the corporate world. You start a business. The business is not picking up yet. You're a failure. You're this. You're that. You know, your kids are all over the place. Now you're a bad mom. Now you have this issue. Now you have that issue. You know, many things. Your family's members say that you're not always there for them or this and that. Or you're trying to protect yourself because you have toxic family members. So now you're not helpful. You're selfish. You only worry about yourself. You don't check on other people. You know, all of these things. You know, even in a marriage, you know, your marriage is not going well for whatever reason. Now you can't keep a man. Now you can't hold your family together. Now you can't do this. Now, you know, you're embarrassed and ashamed. You don't want people to know anything's going on. So you don't seek help on time. Just many things. And that's the problem. You know, like, these are the situations, yes. But, yeah, I don't know why they're doing fireworks this late. But they are beautiful. Oh, they ain't playing. But, yes, you hold all of these things together. And you hold all of these things over you. And that's the problem. You know, this situation equates this when that's not true. You know, this situation equating that negative thing is that sticky note you just made your problem. Instead of you saying, okay, you know, my kid's going through something right now. What is the root of this? How do I help? How can I support? You know, this is all happening while I have a whole bunch of drama at work. How do I find my balance? Okay, you know, how do I take it in? How do I take them into consideration and also take my health into consideration? Because, y'all, I don't care what people say about being selfless and things like that. This is why God is here, and this is why God says cast your cares on him, because the thing is that you can't pour from an empty pot. So you need to know God's love. You need to be filled with God's love. You need to find that time even in your busy life, regardless. Because let me tell y'all, if you like somebody, y'all make time for y'all husbands. Y'all make time for y'all boyfriends, fiancés, you know, all of these people that you love and care about. That new boy you talking to that you think is going to be your husband. Whoever it is, you make time for these people. Even if you have a busy schedule and you have a lot going on with work. You know, we make time to eat. We make time to do things that are important to us. But say that we're too busy to spend 30 minutes in conversation with God. 30 minutes just sitting with God. Even if it's just like, Lord, I don't know what it is. You know, I don't even have words to pray. But I ask that you help me. And if there's anything you want to tell me now. And just sit in silence and see what you hear. You know, I mean, even if you can't read a scripture, everybody know the Bible app is free. Get the Bible app and just read that scripture of the day. If that's all you can commit to. You know, the thing is that God, he looks at the heart. So it's your effort. It's you actually wanting to have a relationship with him. But in order for you to do the things that are required for you to be there for your kids, for you to be there for your husband, for you to be there for those that you care about, for your family, for your parents, for your nieces, for your nephews, for your workers, for your employees, for whoever it is that you know needs you, for you to be there for them, you need a bit of an overflow, because if you only have enough for you and you give it away, you end up parched, drained, dehydrated. And that just makes for a bad situation. And that's where emotional intelligence comes in. You need to know your tank. You need to know how much more you need. You need to know what is going on in your life that is causing you to feel this way, or causing you to react in this way, or why you are going down a hill, or constantly complaining about the same thing. Because sometimes, y'all, we use different things to cope for things that have been going on for so long that we feel we're immune to it, but you're actually coping in another way, whether it's insomnia, overeating, undereating, whatever it is, you know, just irritability, whatever it is, you know, starting to feel like you're depressed, starting to feel anxious, headaches, whatever it is. Like, a lot of times these things that present themselves physically, it's weight you've been carrying, and you don't need to carry it. Cast your cares on him, because he cares for you. You know, lay down your burdens and take up his yoke, his light. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and know that all else will be added unto you. Your God, our God, will supply all of our needs according to his riches and glory. You know, he's never seen the righteous forsaken, nor their children begging for bread. Some gonna work out. Something is going to work out. You trust him. You love him. You believe in him. You give him it. Something is going to work out. And I know that's easier said than done when you're in it, because it looks like a lot. And I don't know about y'all, but if something don't happen in about an hour, I'm like, okay, well, what is plan B? what we gonna do? Because I don't see it. But you got to be patient. You know, you have to tap into the fruits of the spirit. You got to be self-controlled. Don't you pick that back up. You surrendered it. You let it go. You put it down. You gave it to the Lord. Don't you pick it back up. Mm-mm. You have self-control to do that. You have self-control. You have the spirit of patience. You can be patient. You know? We have to tap into these things that God gives us. And that's that supernatural strength. That's that joy that'll make you sing. That's when you go through a tough situation or you go through a tough season. You may cry from time to time, but when you get to the other side and finally, you know, you are reaping your harvest from persevering, that's when you're like, I thought that this was this. I thought that I was this because this was happening to me. I thought I deserved this to happen to me because I did this and all these other things. And then I gave it to God, and I don't even know how I maneuvered through it because I was so broken in that season. I didn't look like myself in that season. I didn't feel like myself in that season, but I got through it. And now look at how the Lord is blessing me. So y'all, don't carry it. Don't carry it. Don't carry the weight of this world. It's too heavy. And make sure you are filling yourself with the Lord so you have enough to give to others. Because when God gives in abundance. You ask for wisdom, he gives it in abundance. You ask for love, he gives it in abundance. You ask for peace, he gives you peace that surpasses all understanding. When you ask for these things, he gives it in large quantities. And that's the beauty of our God, because now you have more than enough to pass on to your coworker, to your kids, to your spouse, to your friends, to the lady at the grocery store, to whoever it is that's in your life, to, you know, to somebody in your class, to whoever it is, whomever it is. You have more than enough to love your neighbor as yourself and bless those who wrongfully accuse you. Because God is the judge and God is the vindicator. And you don't have to waste any energy over there. Nor do you have to hold that sticky note and say, what do you do with it? Pluck it off. And you keep moving. Seems like foolishness. Until you train your yourself to know spiritual things are different than physical things. And the world knows what to do with chaos. They know what to do with your anger. They know what to do when you pop off at the mouth. They know what to do when you're frustrated and you escalate situations and y'all cussing each other out and acting like the Real Housewives. The world knows what to do with that. But the world doesn't know what to do when you bless somebody wholeheartedly because you just have that much love and you understand that they're hurt. One, it's the enemy using them to get to you. But the enemy only has access to them because there's something broken in them. And that's where they're acting out. And you was delivered from that once. Because I know I used to be an angry person. I know I used to be a very judgmental person. I know I faked my love and my love for self and things like that. Because I just wanted to be okay. I didn't feel like I could actually change my situation or be successful at it. Only to see myself now, I've maintained over 100 pounds down, even with having a child. Even with my weight fluctuating. At least that 100 pounds didn't come back. Praise the Lord. And we ain't ever gonna let it come back in Jesus' name. Ooh. All right. Let me tell you, I don't miss them little leg cramps in the morning. I don't miss that back pain, and I don't miss them knees, okay? Because I like to dance. My knees, too much pressure. It was a lot. It was a lot. And that was happening to me at 21, so you can only imagine. But, yes, it'll be well. It will be well, and it will all work out. But no, we are not our problems. They don't define you. You don't have to stay there. That's not your status. That's not your title. That doesn't define you. God defines you. And what does he say? You're beautifully and wonderfully made. That there's a prosperous plan that he has for you. That you're bold and courageous. That your humility is key to inheriting this land. That you will have an abundance of God's provision. So you will be okay. That you have the power to heal the sick. Through the authority given to you by the name of Jesus Christ. Know who you are. Look up God's promises. And hold on to one. Let that be your verse. If that's whatever you're going through, find a promise. And every time it happens, just repeat that verse. Because God will come through. I love you guys. Stay wonderful. Stay positive. Stay beautiful. Stay blessed. And know you are loved. All right. Bye.